Hi.
Hi, good afternoon.
We're just going to walk through what's on Canvas. Okay, so this week, we're looking at classification. And you will notice from now on, we are spending only 1 week on the different styles of expository writing. Right? So we are looking at classification essays this week. We will also look at different methods of speech delivery. And looking at pronoun antecedent agreements. So the classification essay takes a specific topic and puts it in a larger category. It is almost, it's like the reverse of analysis by division. So an analysis by division, we take the larger category, we take a large item, a unified item, and we break it down into smaller components to help explain what it is. In a classification essay, we're taking a smaller item and placing it in a larger category to help explain what it is. So very similar to biology, for example, where you have species, you have class, you have kingdom, and so on. So there's a classification system. And each rung is a bit of a larger category than the last one, right? So for example, your dustbin terrier is a dog, so that's its species. It belongs to the classification of canine. So it is related to other species in that class, including wolves, foxes, hyenas, and so on. They share similar traits, so they all belong in the same class. So if you wanted to define, if you wanted to suggest a dog as a typical canine, by putting it in the larger category, we can see the other traits of a canine and apply it to the dog. So we're taking a smaller item and we're putting it in a bigger category. So let's look at university. So we use university as the example for our analysis by division. So we're using it now as an analysis for classification, right? So we can put a university in a larger category of a learning institution. So our singular item is university, and we're putting it in a larger category called learning institutions. So we're going to explain what a university is by showing how it fits into the larger category of learning institutions. So the expectation here is that people understand what a learning institution is. So by putting university in that larger category, we can then easily explain what a university is so that people can make inferences drawing from prior knowledge. So the first thing we have to do is determine what makes an institution educational. So what are the traits that an institution should have for it to be educational? We figure out what that is. And the second thing we do is look at how a university matches the traits to be considered an educational institution. So it has the same characteristics, the same traits as what we identify in an educational institution. So, for example, let's say all educational institutions have an academic staff who are qualified to teach the subjects that are offered. All educational institutions have students who attend for instruction. They don't just go to Lyme, they go there to learn. And there's a set timeline or time frame within which you can get this instruction and this education, right? So whether you are going to primary school, secondary school, vocational college, or university, the staff, the academic staff at that school have been trained to teach the subjects that they are offering. Whether you are whether it's a primary school, secondary school, vocational institution, or university, you have students who come specifically to learn the subjects that are offered there. And whether it's a primary school, secondary school, vocational institution, or university, you have a set time frame, which includes the number of years or months spent learning the subjects, as well as the day-to-day time frame. So we attend from, if it's primary school, from 8:30 in the morning to 2. You attend for about 7 years from infants up to standard 5. Primary school, secondary school, 8:30 to 3. You attend for 5 to 7 years, and so on. So there's a set time of instruction. Students have a specific reason for going there, and their staff qualified to teach specific subjects. So we've identified these are the traits that make an institution educational, and then we will match and see if the university has the same traits, do the same things, right? So I'm skipping through these because I need to move them. These are more division. Now, if you are looking up, if you're looking for analysis by division and classification, they tend to group them together because as you can see, they do somewhat similar things. ABD takes a large topic and splits it down into the individual pieces. Classification takes a smaller subject and puts it into a larger category. So they are flip sides of each other. So 9 out of 10 times, if you're looking up these types of essays for extra information online, you're going to see them grouped together. And they're going to explain it rather similarly. Right. So, and I will leave the readings on your own. I will try to find more. I saw some, I need to post them. Take a look at organizing our classification essay. Thank you. Okay, so the examples we saw, and by the way, this is taken from my own work, so if it seems oddly complex, it's because taken from my own work, and I do apologize. The examples that we saw show two ways to organize your classification essay. And notice, when you rewatch the video, you will notice that is the exact same information, just arranged in two different ways. So when we're thinking about outlining or using specific organizational techniques for our essays, it's not that you need new information, it's not that you're rewriting anything. It's just simply that you're splitting up the information to organize it in different ways. So when we come to editing essays, for example, it comes in handy to remember that it's not necessarily that you have to add anything new. You're simply rearranging and shifting around. So once we write something, especially now that we write on computers, it's not set in stone. It's not irreversible. You can shift, you can change, you can move things, right? So again, I will leave the samples. And instead, I just want to stress that when we are doing a classification essay, we're taking a smaller category and putting it in a larger category, right? So let's say, essay, high school cliques is very American. So let's say you're all training to be teachers. Teaching is a profession, or teaching is in a larger category of professions known as educators. It is a specific kind of educator, right? You're all looking at being primary school, or I think we're doing mostly primary school teachers now. So that's a specific type of teacher, but you're in a larger category of educator. So you're in the same professional category as, let's say, from coaches to professors. That's a larger extension of what that professional category is. People in the educational category, that professional category, are all out they're all trained in general and specific topic matters, subject matters. They are generally trained in teaching techniques, how to deliver materials in an education setting. They are dedicated to the pursuit of knowledge in general, and so on and so on. So there are specific traits we can say that all professional educators have, and a teacher has these traits, and therefore the teacher belongs to the larger category of professional educator. So the difference between an ABD and a classification essay, the ABD takes that bigger category and splits it down into subdivisions to help explain the bigger category. Classification takes a small subdivision and puts it in the larger category to explain the subdivision. So if you're thinking about it this way, an ABD is when you have a large category and people need to be informed of the large category, but they might know smaller divisions in that large category and what it does, or breaking it down into its individual, into its component parts will help explain what the whole thing is. On the other hand, classification is where you take something specific that people might not be familiar with, know too much about, but they know generally the larger topic. Right, so I might not know specifically, what's the difference? I might not know specifically what an Asus tablet does, but I know what handheld devices do. So if you explain, okay, well, the Asus tablet is just a handheld device, so it does the same thing as handheld devices. So you're explaining something very specific by showing me how it relates to something larger or more diverse that I might know. So those are the two sides. ABD is taking big, breaking it down. Classification is taking small, putting it in a larger category. So let's look now at pronoun, verb, antecedents. Matching your pronouns with the preceding verb.
Welcome to the week 5 tutorial. In this tutorial, we will discuss pronoun and noun antecedent agreement and the hyphen versus the dash. After this tutorial, you should be able to avoid pronoun noun antecedent errors and distinguish between when to use a hyphen and when to use a dash. So let us look at matching our pronouns to nouns. Remember, there are 8 types of pronouns: demonstrative, relative, indefinite, interrogative, possessive, reflective, intensive, and personal. When looking at pronoun to noun agreement, ask yourself, is a noun a person or not a person? What's the gender of the noun? Is it male or female or neutral? What is the number? Is it singular or plural? Is it the subject or the object of the sentence? When considering pronoun and noun agreement, the typical pronouns that we must pay special attention to are personal, possessive, relative, interrogative, demonstrative, and indefinite. So let's look at personal pronouns. If the answer to the first question is that it's a person, we use I, you, he, she. If it is not a person, an animal or an object, we use it. If it is male, if the noun is male, we use he. If the noun is female, we use she. If it is singular, it is I, you, he, she, it. If it is plural, it is we, you, they. This is also the subject form of the pronoun. If it is the object, we use me, you, him, her for people, it for objects or animals, us, you, them. With interrogative pronouns, in addition to asking if it is a person or not a person, if it's singular or plural, or if it's the subject or the object, we must also consider if it's a particular thing or if it is a general reference. If we are referring to or if the noun is a person, we use who for the subject and whom for the object. If it is a particular thing, we say which. If it is a general reference, we say what. Take a few seconds to read over the chart. With the demonstrative pronouns, the question becomes, is the noun far or is the noun closer? We use that to indicate that when the noun is farther away. We use this to indicate that the noun is nearer to us. The singular, that. The plural, those. Singular, this. Plural, these. We also use this and that when comparing to differentiate between two nouns. Relative pronouns. These are pronouns that link the noun from the first part of the sentence to the rest of the clause, or the second clause in the sentence. Who, whom, which, that, whose, where, when, why, and what. Who relates to people? As a subject, whom is the object form, which relates to animals and objects, that relates to people, animals, and things, with a special caveat that I will explain later. Whose refers to possession and is used with people, so it's related to who. Where refers to place, when, time, why, reason, what. Things. Indefinite pronouns. These are pronouns used to replace nouns that do not have a definite number. In other words, the nouns can't be counted. Typically, indefinite pronouns are treated as singular, some are treated as plural, and some might be treated as singular or plural. let's look at dashes versus hyphens. As Strunk and White state in the Elements of Style, a dash is a mark of separation stronger than a comma, less formal than a colon, and more relaxed than parentheses. We use dashes in place of a colon. For example, cake ingredients are simple, dash, eggs, flour, butter, and sugar. We use it in place of parentheses. For example, Joseph jumped out from behind the bushes, trying hard to scare me, wearing a rubber mask. When we say parentheses, we're referring to a phrase or clause that is parenthetical to the sentence. That is, you can remove it and the sentence will still make sense. Hyphens, on the other hand, are used to connect phonemes, syllables, and words to make compound words. Please watch the appended video for further differentiation between hyphens and dashes.
So let's look at the difference between hyphens and dashes.
Hello, grammarians. Hello, Paige.
Hi, David.
So today we're going to learn about hyphens. What a hyphen is, it's a little stick like this, as opposed to a dash, which is about twice as long. And people confuse them a lot, but they have very different functions. So what a hyphen is used to do is it's used to join two words into one.
All right.
So, for example, we have the word yellow. That's a word with meaning. Mm-hmm. We have the word green. That's a word with meaning.
Yes.
And we may have a word that does fit right in between those two or two at once,
mm-hmm.
Like chartreuse or whatever.
Okay.
You know, but not everybody wants to use the word chartreuse.
No, it's kind of crazy.
Kind of a wacky word. So instead of doing that, you might just want to say yellow-green and connect yellow and green with a hyphen. So a hyphen is joining these two things. But let's say we had a sentence like, her hair was yellow, green were her eyes. You know, and so we're still separating the words yellow and green with a stick. But a dash is longer. And instead of uniting yellow-green, it's separating them the way that, you know, a semicolon might.
Yeah, it's not one thing. It's she has yellow hair and green eyes.
If she had yellow-green hair, that would be a different story.
Yes.
So what's neat about hyphens, and what's kind of confusing about hyphens, is that whether or not we use a hyphen indicates how common a compound phrase is. So Brian Garner in Garner's Modern American Usage and in the Chicago Manual of Style draws this distinction with compound words. And I should first say what a compound word is, right? Mm-hmm. A compound word is two words smacked together somehow, right? So if we take the... So once upon a time, at the dawn of the internet page,
okay,
when dinosaurs walked the earth, and I was just a wee little baby,
yes,
you would refer to getting online,
okay,
right?
Mm-hmm.
And then as it became more and more prominent and more popular, this is what's called an open compound. Then it became online, separated with a hyphen. This is what's called a hyphenated compound.
Makes sense.
And now, when we think about it, it's just an adjective, and it's online, and this is a closed compound.
Right. Okay. It became closed because everyone knows what that means.
Right. So you would use hyphenated compounds when you're kind of in this intermediary stage of acceptedness.
Mm-hmm. So, like, maybe one day in the future, yellow-green
will be a super common
color.
Right.
Right. It's everyone's favorite color. So it'll just be smushed together with no hyphen.
Today is not that day.
So there's a hyphen there.
Right. I think it's also important to hyphenate for clarity.
Mm-hmm.
Let me explain what I mean by that.
Yeah.
So first of all, when I say hyphenate, that's just a word that means to put a hyphen in something.
Yes.
To hyphenify. So if a compound word could be misconstrued or misunderstood, you should throw in a hyphen or check a dictionary or a style guide. So, okay, so Paige.
Yes.
I would like to raise some chickens.
Good idea.
So in order to raise some chickens, I need a chicken coop, right? That
is, yeah, true.
And a coop, right, C-O-O-P, is a place where chickens live. It's like a little enclosure.
Yeah.
But let's say I want to buy this coop from a community-run business, right? What's called a cooperative business or a co-op.
Mm-hmm.
Well, now sometimes it appears like that, like C-O-O-P. But if I said something like, I want to buy my coop from the co-op, like that, it'll end up looking like this.
I want to buy my coop from the coop.
Right.
Or my co-op from the co-op or co-op from the coop or something.
So in order to be clear, it really helps to put in that little hyphen. And that's the difference, right? So you're using this to say, oh, you know, this is actually short for cooperative, you know, because it's operated by a bunch of people working together,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to this word, which is just C-O-O-P.
Right.
So you want to hyphenate for clarity when you can.
Makes sense.
So let's bring all this together, right? So I made a yellow-green coop with the co-op.
Okay, you all worked together to make a yellow-green coop.
Yep.
That's pretty cool.
So we're connecting yellow and green with a hyphen. We're connecting co-op with a hyphen to differentiate it from this word coop. And that's basically what you use hyphens for.
Mm-hmm.
You can learn anything. David out.
Paige out.
So hope that adds a little clarity between a hyphen and a dash. When we are typing, where did I just go? Go away.
Hello, grammarians. Hello, Paige.
Hi, David.
When you're typing in Microsoft Word, for example, to make a dash, you put you type the hyphen twice. So you type the hyphen twice between the two words. Once you type the second word and hit the space bar, you will see it turn into the long dash, right? So remember that a hyphen cannot separate phrases. So it must be, when you're typing it, dash that, hyphen, hyphen, and you will create the dash. Now let's look at types of speech delivery. So happens when you're cheap. Haha, I don't want to pay that. As we're in a communication class, so the next thing we're looking at is types of speech delivery. There are four main types: impromptu, extemporaneous, scripted, and memorized. So let's take a closer look at impromptu as the first style. So an impromptu speech is given without preparation. So say, for example, you go to a wedding and someone goes, hey, make a toast. Or at a birthday party, you know, you should raise a toast. And you're not prepared, so you have to give a speech on the fly, off the top of your head. So that's an impromptu delivery without preparation. So here are some things you can do. Take a minute, might be a full-fledged 60 seconds, might be less than 60 seconds, to come up with the main idea you want to convey. If you're looking at a setting where it's you're invited to say a few words of at an event, open with thanking them for inviting you to speak. Stress your main point, deliver your main message, be brief, try to be as organized as possible. So in that moment to collect your thoughts, write down the main point you want to make, write down, sketch out a bit an organization, an outline, if you will, very briefly for how you want to make your remarks. Then you close by thanking the person for giving you the opportunity to speak. And then you sit down and hopefully wait for everyone to clap. So be brief, be focused, and be brave.
Amelanie Fernando, knowledge is power, or is it? Knowledge is power, or is it Amelanie Fernando?
If I tell you that I know how to make a book.
Hey, now's not the time to freeze.
Bomb and detonate it right here, what would you do? Would you run away, call 119, or would you call me a liar? Mr. Kanteshe, ladies and gentlemen, science and technology has changed my life so much. So I go to bed thinking that the solar system has 9 planets, but wake up to learn that Pluto was a big fat lie. The other day, I Googled how to make a bomb. Few pieces of wire, a battery, an alarm. 30 minutes later, I had a bomb. I went to my mom. Amma, if you don't buy me that leather shoes I want, I'm going to blow up your kitchen. Oh yeah? And how would you do that? Well, I Googled online and now I have a bomb. Well, does this Google person also tell you the wisdom on how to use it? Wisdom? What wisdom? Sweetheart, you may know how to use something, but that doesn't mean you have wisdom on how to really use it. The great question of our generation is not how to produce. It's how to share. It's not how to create. It's how to share. It's not about blowing up, but about the wisdom on how really to use it. When I'm old and gray, I hope that I will look back about my generation and say that in my generation, knowledge was not power. True power was wisdom. Over to you.
So you can see in this example that she is speaking off the top of her head, especially in that little part in the speech where she gets stuck and she repeats share and then she corrects herself because she's thinking, she hasn't written anything down. She's not prepared. She is making up the speech as she goes. But notice that the confidence that she has helps so much in making the speech engaging, believable, and understandable. So let's look at another example.
Okay, ready? Somebody give me a topic.
Strawberries.
Strawberries? We're going with strawberries, okay. So now you would have roughly about 2 minutes, okay?
Oh, stop it.
Strawberries. My thesis is going to be Tampa is excellent for strawberries. My 2 points are going to be food and festival. Okay? On your day, on Wednesday, you do that for about 2 minutes. Do you remember going to fairs as a kid? Does anybody remember going to like carnival? Or do you remember going to the arcade? Or do you remember going to like maybe a 4-H festival with animals? Well, imagine all of that together and you get the Florida Strawberry Festival. My name is Chris, and as someone who's lived in Tampa now for almost 15 years, strawberries, I have learned, are an integral part of this region. And that's because Tampa has the Strawberry Fest, and that is a celebration of all things strawberry. So for the next couple of minutes, I'd like to tell you a little bit about the food, strawberries, and the festival that ensues, because this is something that everyone who lives in this region, whether you're a student or a resident, needs to experience at least once. Let's first talk a little bit about the food. Tampa is known to be what's a subtropical climate zone, which means we are perfect for growing strawberries both in and out of season, which means that we can harvest the strawberries almost all year round, but specifically in February, when they're actually the ripest that they can be. And they're harvested from here out in the county of Tampa Bay. What's good about them is that they are a special strawberry known to this region, which means they're flavorful and tasty. And the people in this area have been celebrating the strawberry for over 100 years. Speaking of celebrations, let's talk a little bit about the actual celebration known as the Florida Strawberry Festival. This is held out in the county, and it's wonderful because what the farmers do is that they bring all of the strawberries together, and they have people who harvest them, they have the farms, they have the independent vendors, they also have things for the kids, they have farm animals, they have events and concerts, specifically live music, comedians, and rock bands. And so there's something for everybody. The Florida Strawberry Festival goes on for 2 weeks in February, and it's so big that the Strawberry Crest schools out in the county actually had the day off, and sometimes the weekends off, the weeks off of school. So today, when asked about strawberries, I thought immediately about the Central Florida region, our climate zone, and the food that is the strawberry. While we don't harvest them all year round, we do harvest them specifically in February when they're ripest. Then we celebrate it with the festival known as the Florida Strawberry Fest. It's one of the biggest fundraisers and economic boosts in the region in February. It's got farm animals, rock bands, concerts, and the best thing, food. So hopefully when you think of strawberries, you'll come to Central Florida Strawberry Festival. And this is something that all of us can experience, whether we're students or residents. And you'll never again forget about why strawberries are so important to this region. Thank you. Okay? Couple of misnomers in there.
So again, you see here that he actually takes a few minutes to jot down his thoughts before he starts to speak. So he doesn't immediately start speaking. They gave him a topic. He took a minute and jotted down his thoughts, what his main idea and how he will develop that very quickly. He was brief and to the point. But again, his confidence carried him through that speech. And of course, he has an extra boost of confidence because he's teaching the class how to do an impromptu speech. The next type of speech is extemporaneous. So the extemporaneous is planned, but not scripted. So we plan it out in advance. You know your topic ahead of time. You're able to brainstorm. You're able to come up with an outline and an organization. And then you write down a few notes. So an extemporaneous delivery is prepared but unscripted. So you're not reading out your speech. So to prepare, examine your topic, locate your stance. What is your position on the topic? Identify your purpose and main idea. Brainstorm around this purpose and main idea to come up with all the support that you will need to flesh out that main idea. Organize your thoughts, so write an outline. Doesn't have to be formal, but you start to organize these different ideas so that you will get a logical flow. Jot down notes and prompts. So instead of, you don't need to write full sentences, you could just write down things that would jog your memory as you're speaking. So bullet points, specific words and so on that will trigger, oh, I'm supposed to say this now. And then practice in front of a mirror, in front of other people. Practice, practice, practice. So let's look at a few examples.
Have you ever wondered how those great speakers that you love to listen to have a conversational approach to their delivery? We're going to teach you how to have what's called an extemporaneous delivery style. Coming up. Hello, friends. I'm Alex Lyon and communication coach. This channel is here to help you increase your impact and lead your teams to higher levels of excellence. One of the ways you can do that is through better presentation skills. Today, we're going to unpack how to speak extemporaneously, in other words, conversationally. Let's put it this way. Nobody wants to hear you give a memorized presentation. Nobody wants to listen to you read a presentation word for word. And here's how I know this. Do you want to listen to someone read a presentation word for word? Do you want to listen to someone like a robot give you a memorized word-for-word presentation? Nobody likes it. And unless you're president of the United States and you're using teleprompters, you probably won't ever be asked to do this in a professional setting. Almost everybody across the board that's at that high level of speaking uses what we call extemporaneous delivery style. And that means when you know the material so that you can speak conversationally with limited notes in a structured way. Now, it sounds pretty basic and you appreciate it when you see it, but it actually takes quite a bit of work to get there. But once you know how to do it this way, I doubt you'll ever want to go back to reading your notes word for word again. So first, let's talk about how to do this. The first tip is that you have to commit to a structure. The structure is the backbone of the whole presentation that helps you keep your place and helps you move forward according to your plan. You're going to need a really clear introduction, body, and conclusion. And within each of those sections, your introduction, for example, you're going to have certain parts that you hit, four parts of the introduction. You're going to know your clear two or three or four main points you're going to hit with nice transitions and information in each of those buckets. And you're going to have a really clear conclusion. You're going to know how you end. So you have to have a clear structure. If you don't have a clear structure, it's going to be very difficult to get comfortable enough to have a conversational style. The second tip is that you're going to have to practice probably more than you realize. I recommend practicing a presentation about 10 times. Now, that might seem like a lot. However, over the years, I've been doing coaching and teaching college for about 20 years in professional settings. It's really no different. If you only practice 2 to 3 times, you're just not going to do that well. That's not enough repetitions to get completely comfortable with a topic, completely comfortable expressing yourself and connecting while you're sharing information. Time and time again, when I pull really skilled speakers aside, I say, yeah, but how many times you practice? The number 10 comes up a lot. Some people that are exceptionally gifted might only practice 8 or so times. Most people, 10 or even more. So practice about 10 times. Now, the way you practice 10 times becomes really critical if you want to speak conversationally. Let's say the first time you practice, you use full set of notes. Now, the number one killer is too many notes. And so you want to pare down your notes to the bare minimum that you need to give that presentation. So you start off the first, and you, let's say you're practicing 10 times. The first 2 or 3 times you practice, you have your full set of notes. The more you practice, the more you should try to get away from that. Look up a little more often so that in the next 2 to 3 times you practice, I recommend cutting those notes about in half. So maybe you have, let's say you start off with 4 pages of notes, cut it down to about 2 pages of notes. And instead of full sentences, you want to pare it down to maybe half sentences. And then you practice it another 2 to 3 times. And then the last 2 or 3 times you practice, you should be all the way down to very simple bullet talking points that are just maybe even a single word or a short phrase. And the goal here is that as you're practicing that 8th, 9th, or 10th time, all you have to do is look at your notes just for a moment and you see maybe even one key word. Maybe it just says Hawaii. and you know you're going to tell a story about Hawaii that lasts about 30, 40 seconds. So now there's no reason to really look at your notes beyond glancing down, seeing the word, and putting your eyes back up on your listeners and connecting with them conversationally in that story about Hawaii. So you want to pair your notes way back and practice that way. So the next tip is, each time you practice it, say it in a variety of ways. In other words, don't get locked in to using the exact same sentences, the exact same phrases each time you present. I even sometimes deliberately will say things differently each time I do it because it gives me another way to express it. In fact, a telltale sign for me when I'm watching a speaker and I can tell they're just memorizing this word for word is they might start a sentence a certain way and then not remember how to finish it. And so they'll go back and they'll start it over again a little differently so they can land at the end of the sentence the way they originally practiced it. That's going to start to sound very robotic. You want to say things in as many ways as possible when you're practicing so that in the moment, no matter what happens, you can move ahead in that presentation smoothly and still maintain that nice conversational approach. So practice it in a variety of ways. The other things you want to do is keep your practice sessions realistic. Keep them real world. So for example, I like to, even though I'm alone when I'm practicing, oftentimes I like to look up away from my notes while I'm practicing because it's a good habit to get into to look up. So I practice only looking at my notes. Well, that's a habit I'm ingraining so that when I go to my actual presentation, I'm going to have a habit of looking at my notes. So you want to practice by looking up. Sometimes, in fact, and I know a good friend of mine actually set up stuffed animals and even put pillows inside of winter coats and put faces and paper on top of them. And then when they were practicing that presentation, they were looking at their stuffed animals and looking at those dummies they made. And during the presentation, it was much easier because they had practiced that way to connect because they made their practicing realistic. Now, obviously, they're not real people, but maybe you have a roommate or even a dog that you can present to keep it real. Once you're really comfortable and you've kept it real, sometimes people will even add distractions. So they might turn the television on in the background or some music on in the background or do it in a somewhat public area. You might look a little crazy, but if you can present conversationally and get through your outline in a nice extemporaneous fashion, even with distractions, then you're much more likely to speak conversationally in the moment. You never know, for example, when there's going to be someone outside with a jackhammer, someone outside with a lawnmower, someone's going to come in late, someone's going to leave early. In the moment, every little distraction can really heighten your nervousness and throw you off if you're not prepared for it. So the benefits of speaking extemporaneously cannot be underestimated. First of all, audiences prefer this style of delivery from presenters far and away. Nobody wants to hear you memorize or read your presentation. Believe me, you don't want to do it any more than you want to listen to it. And this is a skill that you can build on. If you can break the habit and get away from that safety net of all those notes, extemporaneous delivery, that conversational approach, is a really great skill to build on. You can use it in all kinds of professional settings. You're going to bring it with you for the rest of your life. So I highly recommend you take the plunge, pare those notes down to the bare minimum, and start practicing in a realistic way. So, question of the day, what are your tips for conversational delivery, for making things much more extemporaneous? I would love to hear your comments in that section below. So thanks, God bless, and I hope that you speak more conversationally in your very next presentation.
Okay, so I must add the caveat here that just because he is talking, his main purpose is to sell the idea of extemporaneous, right? And so he's disparaging against scripted and memorized to make his point. But there are ways to read and there are ways to recite that will also sound conversational and engaging. Just because you're reading or just because you're reciting something you learned by heart doesn't mean you're automatically going to sound robotic. And it depends on your confidence level and your comfort level. So bear that in mind, even though he's trying to convince you that nobody wants to hear you read. Nobody wants to hear you read monotonously. No one wants to hear you recite with no feeling. So let's add those explanations to what he's saying. Let's look at another example.
The second speaker is code 212. The question, was the U.S. war in Afghanistan in vain?
In one of the most classic episodes of arguably the most classic TV show of all time, SpongeBob SquarePants, SpongeBob, the main character, and his buddy Patrick Starr go around their hometown of Bikini Bottom and set literally every building inside of the city on fire. After the deed is done, SpongeBob and Patrick walk to the middle of the city, where SpongeBob looks around at all of the burning buildings collapsing to the ground and says, "Patrick, we did it. We saved the city." This is exactly the US's approach and response to the current war in Afghanistan. Because despite the fact that a war has currently been going on in Afghanistan for the last 16 years, and the US has been involved for 16 years, we're still having to ask the question today as to whether or not this war was a failure. In fact, on June 15th of 2017, Reuters reported that President Donald Trump made the executive decision to send 4,000 more US troops to the nation of Afghanistan. And upon understanding that this conflict has been long-lasting, intensifying over recent years, and the US is only getting more and more involved, it's crucial that we reflect, analyze, and ask the question, was the US war in Afghanistan in vain? The answer to which is an unfortunate no, because the conflict has only intensified despite US action, as we'll understand by looking to three key areas of analysis. First, we'll understand the US has a simple-minded, myopic perspective on the current Afghan conflict. Second, we'll see the US's proposed solution, troop surges, have been a disastrous failure at bringing Taliban to the negotiating table for peace. And third, we'll see that the proof is in the pudding. Despite US action and intensifying US action, the conflict inside of Afghanistan has only gotten worse. The first key reason that the US's war inside of Afghanistan has been in vain is because the US has a myopic perspective on the Afghan conflict as it currently exists. Foreign Affairs magazine explained on May 13th of 2017 that there's not one problem facing Afghanistan. There's actually five primary issues: conflicts involving ethnicity, regional conflicts, domestic conflicts, international conflicts, and the terrorism problem. And as per usual, the United States is only concerned with international terrorism. Foreign Affairs explained that this is at the heart of the US's problem, because as they look more and more to addressing the Taliban and terrorist organizations such as that, they fail to address other underlying key issues. Stratford Global Intelligence explained in mid-2015 that if the United States only worries about international terrorism in the nation of Afghanistan, that means the Taliban, they fail to address other domestic instability creators, like regional civil conflicts, domestic instability in the government, and regional conflicts in Afghanistan with countries like Pakistan. Clearly, the United States is only concerned with addressing the Taliban, which is one of the key problems inside of Afghanistan. But moreover, they're not even addressing the issue of the Taliban sufficiently, or international terrorism as a whole. Because as an article from The Economist in February of 2017 notes, the Taliban isn't the only terrorist organization inside of Afghanistan. Instead, there's 20 of them. But the United States is only really addressing the Taliban. Therefore, the United States is myopic, or simple-minded in their perspective and approach to the Afghan conflict in two ways. First, they're only addressing the terrorism problem. But second, they're not even doing that correctly. By only addressing the Taliban and ignoring 19 other terrorist organizations that are creating instability inside of Afghanistan, the US is failing and continuing a war that has been declared in vain. But the second reason that the war in Afghanistan has been in vain is because our proposed solutions, troop surges, have failed to create domestic stability. An article published by the Center for Strategic and International Studies on January 9th of 2017 outlines the US's key strategy to addressing the instability inside of Afghanistan, noting that whether it's President Bush, President Obama or President Trump, their primary strategy has been troop surges or the installations of tens of thousands of new U.S. military personnel in an attempt to bring stability. But unfortunately, these have been disastrous. As the Christian Science Monitor explained in an article published in February of this year, U.S. troop surges have never corresponded to a reduction in violence from the Taliban. In fact, at the peak of U.S. military personnel in 2010, there were about 100,000 U.S. troops occupying Afghanistan. Yet even at this time, when 1/10 of a million individuals was occupying Afghanistan, the Christian Science Monitor notes that that the Afghan terrorist organization Taliban was not a step closer to reducing their violence, killing less citizens, or negotiating towards peace. Therefore, the second key understanding that we must have is that the U.S.'s proposed solution to the Afghan conflict and our primary strategy in the Afghanistan war, troop surges, has disastrously failed at bringing stability to the nation of Afghanistan. But third and finally, the proof is in the pudding. Unfortunately, the United States has been in Afghanistan for the past 16 years. And despite our actions, no stability has been created. Instead, the problem has only gotten worse. The Strategic Studies Institute noted in March of 2017 that ever since 2003, the United States has consistently gotten more and more involved in the nation of Afghanistan. Yet that same article notes that every time the U.S. ramps up military personnel in Afghanistan, it corresponds with an increase in violence, civilian casualties, and terrorist attacks. Therefore, it's abundantly clear that U.S. action in the nation of Afghanistan has not created stability, it has not minimized terrorism, and has not ameliorated the domestic concerns that the Taliban has created. Instead, it's only made the situation worse. The Washington Post explained in late 2016 that it's arguable that U.S. action in the Afghanistan war has actually made the situation worse and enforced the United States to be more and more involved, creating a cycle of violence and involvement on the part of the United States. This is clear, because what it represents is that the United States is getting involved in the nation of Afghanistan, creating more violence, and then hearing more and more calls for the United States to get more involved because of the very violence they created. Therefore, the third and final reason that it's clear that the Afghanistan war was declared and carried out in vain is because it's only been counterproductive, contributing to more violence than it has solved for. By the end of the episode, SpongeBob and Patrick actually realize that perhaps setting the city on fire didn't save the city. And it's about time the United States comes to the same conclusion in Afghanistan, because the Afghanistan war has clearly been carried out in vain, as we understand through three key areas of analysis. First, the simple-minded, myopic perspective and approach to the current Afghan conflict. Second, the proposed solution, troop surges, failing at creating stability. And third, the evidence of working counterproductively inside of the nation of Afghanistan in creating stability. SpongeBob and Patrick may not be the smartest, which is exactly why it's time for the United States to get smarter than them and realize that setting cities or countries on fire doesn't save them. Thank you.
Speaker 212 will be questioned by Speaker 276.
You argue that America has a very singular and concentrated focus on the Afghani war. But why can't the Trump administration broaden and expand our view of Afghani problems?
They can, but the framing of the question asked whether or not the U.S. war in Afghanistan was in vain. And in the last 16 years, it's indisputable that it was, despite what the Trump administration can do right in the future.
You argue that the war itself was in vain, but was there truly no increase in Afghani living conditions when we toppled the Taliban in 2001?
The article from, I believe, the Christian Science Monitor that I cited in February of 2017 indicated that violence, civilian casualties, and terrorist attacks correspond with an increase in U.S. troops. So maybe some conditions have improved, but lives are being lost as a result of U.S. action.
You argue that America had a very singular and one-minded view of military doctrine for the last 15 years. But did America ever change or re-examine our military approach in that time span?
The evidence that I have seen indicates that they did not. Instead, it indicates that they have employed the same strategy of troop surges over the last 16 years, which ultimately contribute to a cycle of violence.
You argued that the Afghani war was entirely in vain. But wouldn't that imply that Afghani problems are entirely beyond reconciliation and the country is beyond salvation?
There's a chance that the United States can help Afghanistan in some capacity. But unfortunately, the war that we have been carrying out inside of Afghanistan has not been the creation of peace, and it hasn't led to any peace in the process.
Why haven't Americans been fully able to completely destroy terrorist organizations like the Taliban?
I wish I knew, but what I do know is that as a result of U.S. action and an increased troop surge, the Taliban is emboldened, tries to balance against us, and ramps up their terrorist activities.
Congratulations.
So you can see in... He prepared for that speech, practiced it a whole lot. We know it's extemporaneous because he's able to answer questions at the end. So it's not like he has memorized everything. But you can also spot the notes he would have made and would have drilled into his brain, which would have been the dates and citations. But other than that, he has practiced enough, become comfortable enough that he can deliver a speech like that without having to memorize or read from a script. So the next style of delivery is scripted. This is where you write out your speech. Every single word, you write out a script and you read it to the audience. So you prepare and read a speech. And this is why reading aloud becomes a very important skill. So that you are not, you don't sound mechanical, you don't sound boring. You learn to combine the script with vocal delivery techniques to make it more interesting, to make it sound more lively, to make it sound more conversational. So you will treat your speech like an essay. So as you did with the extemporaneous speech, prepare your, examine your topic, locate your stance, identify your purpose and main idea, brainstorm, organize, draft it out. And then you would write the full speech based on this outline. And you will edit. But the best way to do this is as you are practicing in front of a mirror or with a friend, reading it aloud, read it with a pencil or a pen and scratch out or note places that you need to make some adjustments and go back and fix those as you draft it so that you are matching what's on the paper with how you feel comfortable delivering it. So you might find that, you know, it's running too long. I think I could take this out, or this repetition here doesn't work like I want it to. This joke doesn't land like I think it should. And so you can edit as you practice. So not only are you getting familiar with your content, you're also shaping the language on the page to match your delivery style, your vocalics, your modulations, and so on.
How to sound natural when you're reading a script. Perhaps you've been asked to make a presentation, and the presentation you're giving is very specific. You need to stick to a script. Or you've been asked to honor somebody at an event, and the words are going to be up on the screen for you to read from. Or you're going to be using a teleprompter. Again, in that same situation, you're giving out an award, and so the words will be there for you. Well, how can you sound natural yourself? Be the best you can be, the most authentic self, when you're reading. In this video, I'll show you some tried and true techniques to make that happen for you so that you are authentic, natural, easygoing every time. Let's get started. Recently, I had the privilege of working with one of my clients on set using a teleprompter. Now, this client of mine is somebody who is used to being on camera. However, the way that they're used to being on camera is talking on camera, just as I'm talking to you right now, extemporaneously, which is much easier because I've thought about what I'm going to say, I've rehearsed it a few times, I know why I'm talking to you, I've imagined who it is that I'm talking to, and I want to make you feel a certain way. So it's I've done what we've talked about in the video about how to sound natural in front of a camera. But for this client, they had to go from being a person who would interview celebrities, interview people very naturally, being able to talk about things just extemporaneously, to suddenly having to read from a teleprompter, read from a script, because each of these vignettes that this person was doing for their job was specific. It was on set, hair, makeup, lighting, camera, all of it. This is for a major network. So, like a news person, they would read what's in front of them. Now, if you notice with news people, and we'll talk about that in another video, but with news people, there tends to be a rhythm. There tends to be a sort of up and down sort of rhythm. So they'll say, the news at 7 o'clock, and we'll be right back. There's this little up and then down landing. Well, because my client had been earlier in their career working as a newscaster, that kind of reading came into this work. However, the environment of what they were doing in this on-camera work now was to be natural, was to be themselves. And in fact, when you watch, you would have no idea that they were reading. I had seen them do their work before I got to work with them, and I didn't realize they were reading. But what I did see was a sort of stiffness, a sort of unnaturalness. That thing we talk about, once the camera turns on, we start to get aware of everything we're doing, our hands, our body, our face, our voice, everything. So what can you do if you're going to be reading from a teleprompter, or in fact, reading from a speech? How do you sound natural? Well, number one, practice reading out loud. Take anything. Pick up a book, a magazine, your iPad, your tablet, and read out loud. Just practice reading out loud. It's so key. You know, we take it for granted that, oh, we're just reading and we can read it, it'll be fine, no big deal. But it's an art. Some of you might be really good at it right now. But for most of us, it's an art to practice. That's why actors practice reading their lines, taking their lines off of the page. It has to flow from you. That's why voice and speech is so important. In fact, with my client that I'm talking about, we were working on voice and speech before they got their gig. So work on reading out loud. Number two, make it come to life. Well, Patrick, of course I want to make it come to life. I mean, how do I do that? This is how you do it. Images. See what it is that you're talking about. Imagine it in your mind's eye. If you see what it is, then you can paint a picture to the other person. How many times have we heard somebody get up in front of an audience and they talk? It's just the words are here. They're reading their script and their words are like this. There's not much life to them. Or perhaps they're reading their script and there is a life to them, but they're not really giving you any sort of feeling or any sort of color. It's as simple as they're not seeing what it is they're talking about. That's the wonderful thing about acting training. As an actor, you discover images. You are asked to explore images. whatever that is, images in your own experience that you've gone through in your life, imaginary experiences that you could imagine being and seeing. Like when you're a little kid and you're playing dress up, you're playing princesses and princes, you're running around, you're playing these parts. You imagine yourself in these roles. You'll even dress yourself up because you imagine yourself in these roles. And you can see what is, let's say you put on a little costume when you were a kid, maybe it was a sheet, and that sheet became your cape, and suddenly you are a superhero. It's imagination. And that's what I'm asking you to do, is use your imagination to see the images. Because it's images that speak to people. That's why we are so influenced by what we see on TV. Watch a program these days. Most shows you'll watch, it's image after image after image after image. Turn the volume off of something and you'll see how it's boom, 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 boom. We are inundated with images. Well, that's wonderful, but when it comes time to be person to person, mano a mano, person to person, you are just you. You could be given a background, you could be made up, but at the end of the day, it's you talking to another person. And whether it's a camera or an audience, you want to be able to connect to your audience. And the first step is connecting to those images, those things you're talking about. So those are the three things. Number two and number three kind of go together. But first is practice reading out loud. Number two is make your words come to life. And how do you do that? By seeing the images. So as you practice reading out loud, I want you to practice seeing these things. You know, many of my clients are parents, and they'll talk about reading to their kids at nighttime. That is a wonderful way to practice getting different voices, getting your imagination working, getting connected, because a little kid is a tough audience. They want to hear the story read. They want to hear the story brought to life. And that's what I'm asking you to do, is bring the story to life. So you'll be glad to know with my client, as we worked with the teleprompter, and we brought these images to life, so they weren't just being read. There wasn't that newscaster talk, that newscaster kind of cadence. Things went so well, and they continue to go so well because they're focused. In my next video, I want to talk to you about being on camera and some simple techniques you can use to make sure that you come across as natural and authentic while you're reading something on camera and you want to connect to your audience. If you liked my video, which I know you did, you're already here to the end, give me a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel.
So here he gives you some tips on how to read more naturally. And it's going to sound like a broken record, but read, 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 read. Practice reading aloud. For those of you who are parents, and he gives them very good advice on how you could sneak in reading aloud practice into your everyday life. Read to your children, read aloud, bring it to life. Practice being able to read anything at the drop of a hat. And again, if you combine just in general, reading aloud and reading with being connected to what you're reading so that you bring it to life, and actively practicing a scripted speech, you can get to that conversational delivery that is so prized and people look forward to. So let's look at another example.
I love sushi. True statement. Also the name of the single greatest Japanese restaurant in the Greater Bay Area. It was on a whim that I discovered this magical little place in downtown Santa Cruz, but I think it was fate that brought me to it. Because really, isn't it fate that brings all of us to our best kept secrets? I love sushi's a little shabby on the outside, but I think that's what makes it a gem. The neon open sign, slightly shady parking lot, and odd location don't quite match the friendly atmosphere once you open the doors. Upon entering the restaurant, you're greeted by friendly waitresses, seated immediately, and offered tons of free food. But it's not just free food, it's awesome free food. Edamame, California rolls, miso soup. If you've ever been to dinner at a Japanese restaurant, you know how important these things are to your meal. But they usually add quite a bit to your bill. Not here. And I wasn't just bribed into liking this place. The service is great too. Friends of mine have enough confidence in the waitresses and the menu to say upon ordering, surprise me today. And trust me, there's nothing funny about the odd names for the rolls like the Jenny Love. These rolls are plentiful and, simply put, amazing. The good vibe of the restaurant is matched, even doubled, by Mr. Kim, the owner. He constantly checks on his tables and genuinely wants to know how your meal is going. The walls are decorated with endearing pictures of him and local surfers, even some celebrities. Mr. Kim's a nice guy, and his presence also means potentially more free stuff. For you and I, no. But even underage customers are still fully entertained by the fact that if you have a sake bomb on your table, Mr. Kim will challenge you to see who can drink one faster. And trust me, he never fails to rise to the occasion. Some of the funniest times I remember here are when Mr. Kim gulps down a cup of beer and sake faster than most customers can even pick up their drink. And he has enough experience that he promises to pay for another drink for you if he loses. And the entertainment doesn't just stop there. On Friday and Saturday nights, my favorite time to go, the back room turns into the funniest karaoke bar you've ever seen. Large parties are also always accommodated and around the restaurant, making you feel at home in all the excitement and free food. Lastly, and best of all, after paying your extremely reasonable bill, like any good Japanese restaurant, you can grab all the dum-dum lollipops your little heart desires. Perhaps they'll make up for the remorse you'll feel once you have to leave this place. All the while, your subconscious echoes the quite fitting name of the establishment, I love sushi. Thank you.
So you can see from her delivery that she has practiced enough that she can look up, make eye contact, and go back to her notes, to her written speech. So just to stress, practice, practice, practice. Now the last delivery style is memorized. This is where you write out the speech and you learn it word for word, and then when you're delivering, you're reciting from memory. The main advantage here, of course, is that you get to make eye contact. You get to move around. You get to be more lively because you don't have a script to read from. You don't even have notes. But you have to memorize your words and you have to memorize your vocalic technique. Also, when you're doing this reciting from memory, do not freak out if you forget the exact phrasing of the sentence. And this goes for reading as well. So if you look up from reading your script, say the sentence not exactly as it's written, do not go back and try to read what you wrote. Move on. The important thing is that with all the practicing is that you remember what your point is that you're making. And because you remember what the point is that you're making, even if you go a little off script, no pun intended, you won't fluster yourself. You will catch yourself. So in the last example we looked at when she's reading, we see she goes off script. There's a slight pause because she's gone off script. But she's able to recover because she said what she wanted to say. And you will only be able to make sure of that if you practice, practice, practice before you give your speech. So let's look a little bit again at and you can go over these at your own pace. So we have talked about methods of delivery. We've talked about in there what makes good delivery, you know, being conversational, seeming to, you know, connecting with your audience, not being stiff, not sounding like you're reading or reciting. Even if you are reading or reciting, there are ways to work around that. And so our main goal in giving a presentation is that we are communicating. So you're the sender and you are the receiver. the main medium right now is doing a presentation, is a speech. So you want to have that lovely loop, that feedback. And that feedback will come by audience reaction and specific questions that your audience might ask at the end of your presentation. So whether you are doing an impromptu speech, extemporaneous reading, or reciting from memory, you do not want the audience to be overly aware of the type of delivery you're doing. You want them to focus on the message. So whatever type of speech you're doing, you want to be organized. You want to know what your main point is, and you want to be able to express that main idea quickly, clearly, and in an organized way. So, depending on your setting, that will determine the degree of formality. So if you are speaking, if you're giving a toast at your friend's birthday party, for example, someday in the distant future when we no longer have COVID, the expectation is not that you're going to be very formal. You're not going to stand in parliamentary style and say, "Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, to whom I will deliver this speech." You want something that will be, you know, closer to a register that suggests the level of friendship, familiarity, and so on. You want to sound natural. You want to be animated, but not too animated. You don't want your gestures to overthrow or obscure your meaning. You don't want your face to be overly too expressive again, but you want to show emotion in both your movements and your facial expressions so that people feel engaged, that you're not a robot talking to them. So we talked about the methods of delivery. Again, going backwards, you can read a script. You can speak with no preparation. Someone just calls you up to speak and you make a speech. So here are some tips again in terms of really bringing it home, and after you take a minute to organize your thoughts, you know, make sure and use your transitions. In speaking, it's even more important that we are organized, because whereas if you write it in an essay, you can flip someone, your reader can flip back and forth and find it. In a speech, once it's out of your mouth, it's gone. They will remember the gist. And so they might not remember if you split up your information. So that's also something to bear in mind. When you're speaking extemporaneously, again, everyone will stress, be prepared, practice, practice, practice. If you're speaking from memory, obviously you have to practice until you learn the speech. And then, to get that conversational tone, whether you're reading, reciting from memory, looking at your notes, or being extemporaneous, pay attention to the register you need to use. So that would include whether it's formal or informal, how much dialect you want to use, how much standard English you want to use. They will have different effects when giving a presentation. Again, if you're giving a presentation in a birthday party, you might not want to speak standard English all the way. You might want to speak dialect, because again, that suggests familiarity, that suggests friendship and intimacy. Controlling your volume, raising it or lowering it as you need, creating vocal variety in the actual undulation of your voice, playing around with your pitch, playing around with your rate, pausing for effect, trying to avoid filler words like pronunciation, articulation. So all these things you will be playing with. All these things help you create a conversational tone when you're doing your presentation. So as you go through this, it will reiterate some of the things we covered already in terms of vocalics and vocal delivery. if we're looking at kinesics, at body language and your facial expressions and so on, your appearance is important. If you are going to pitch a business, you want to dress in business attire because people will trust you more, because we associate clothing with the role you're expected to play. You don't want your movements to be so distracting that people wonder why this person can't stay still. A lot of the times when we're speaking, it's easier to have a podium because we can hide nervous movements like shifting or weight from foot to foot. You might be able to, if it's a podium with a shelf, you might be able to tap on the bottom shelf and keep yourself still elsewhere. But you don't want to be so stiff that it's a wooden block delivering a speech. So you want to have that mix of natural enough, confident enough movement, but not so much movement that is distracting. And it's the same thing with your gestures. We talk with our hands in Trinidad and Tobago. You don't want the gestures to be so distracting, but you don't want to be unnaturally stiff either. And making eye contact is vital. So if you are reading, especially if you're reading, make sure to look up. Sometimes, depending on your nervous level, you might latch on to 3 or 4 people. If it's if we're in a live space, you might latch on to 3 or 4 people in the audience to make eye contact with, so that the whole audience feels that you are connecting with them. That's what eye contact does. When you're doing a Zoom presentation, let me demonstrate. So when you're doing a Zoom presentation, typically in our Zoom sessions, we're looking at the screen. So if you look at me now looking at the screen, I am not making eye contact. To make eye contact in Zoom, look at your camera. So you're talking, looking at your camera. So we are making eye contact with whoever is watching this video right now. They feel connected because I am looking you, quote unquote, in your eyes. So looking at the screen, looking at the camera. So as you do your presentations near the end of the semester, practice looking at the camera, not at the screen when you're talking. That way we can get to see your eye contact technique. So again, big eye contact. If you're reading from notes, so if you're doing extemporaneous, make sure and glance at your notes. If you have a podium hand, if you're speaking from a podium, it's easy because then you can keep your finger point at the bullet point you are and move on as you move on. So you can mark your progress pretty unobtrusively. Same thing if you're reading from a speech, you can mark your progress. Right. I also recommend if you're reading a speech for presentation, make the font large so that you don't lose your place when you look up. So 14 or 16, so it's large enough when you look back, you can find where you are. You can also break the rules of standard writing and put the sentences either on an individual line or break where you know you want to pause and look up so that, again, you can guide yourself while reading and not get lost. Do not make, again, stressing, do not do too many gestures that might be distracting. Ask rhetorical questions to involve the audience. A rhetorical question is a question that does not need an answer. The answer is implied, right? So, who doesn't like going on vacation? Who wouldn't want to go on a vacation right now? I'm not expecting you to answer these questions. I'm assuming, based on my audience, that your answer would be, everybody wants to go on vacation. So the answer is implied in the question. But you feel, as an audience member, engaged because I'm actually throwing out something to the audience. And practice, practice, practice. The last thing, especially if it's a more formal presentation, is that you might be expected to answer questions at the end. This is where knowing your audience or anticipating your audience is very important. Knowing your audience, you can anticipate the questions they might ask and prepare for it. Be very careful, though, that while you can practice answering questions, and if you're practicing with someone, it's even better, they might throw out questions at the end of your speech, and so you can practice answering those types of questions. Pay close attention to when the audience member is actually asking you something so that you are not simply substituting a prepared question for something you would have gotten in from the audience, right? So be positive, don't roll your eyes, don't be condescending. Be prepared to answer questions. The more you practice, the more you will be able to answer any question that's thrown at you. Right? You can range from, that's an interesting question, but it goes beyond what we are talking about today, but it's certainly something we should look into, to being able to pick out specific information from your speech that someone might want clarified. Again, if you're very organized, this becomes easier to do. You won't necessarily have to flip through the pages. You should be able, after practicing and practicing and practicing, you become so familiar with your topic that you should be able to answer questions based on your topic. So let's look at examples.
Okay, we are attending. Okay. All right. Great. Whenever you're ready.
How many of you, at least at one point in your life, felt as if you fell short of being a virtuous person or lacking some desirable trait or characteristic? Okay, well, while none of us can be perfect, I believe I found someone at Lufkin University who has these traits and characteristics that set a good example for staff, students, and different people from different communities. This person happens to be my intro to music professor, and he's better known as Dr. Peter Terry. Dr. Terry possesses traits and characteristics that I believe set a good example and therefore a great role model to follow. Everyone needs a role model or a example to follow to make us a better person, and I believe Dr. Terry is one of these people. My personal point is that Dr. Terry is a person who demonstrates on a daily basis how to be respectful and respectable. My second main point is that Professor Terry also incorporates humor into his teaching methods as a way to relate to his students in a less serious manner. My third point is that Dr. Terry possesses patience, which is a characteristic that is held in high esteem in discussions pertaining to interpersonal relationships and under several other circumstances. Every day, Dr. Terry walks into class and says good morning to his class, and he does this without fail, and he tries to tell students to participate in the class and that everyone's opinion and everyone's ideas are equal to one another, and therefore he's respectful. Now, in turn for being respectful, he's respected by his peers, and this can often help other students come out of the shell and participate more effectively, and Dr. Terry knows his material well and how to present himself in an ethical manner, and therefore he's respectable. My second main point is that Professor Terry incorporates humor into his teaching methods as a way to relate to his students in a less serious manner. Dr. Terry often tells us not to take life too seriously, and I actually had my own experience with Dr. Terry. And on the first day of college classes, I didn't really know what to expect. I had never gone to college. I had never done anything that even remotely came close to coming to college, and so I was more reluctant to participate in classes. And then whenever Professor Terry told a joke to the class, it made me open up and worry less and made me feel as if I didn't have to worry about this as much anymore versus if I didn't have that experience in his class. And not everyone can incorporate humor, and while they're addressing an audience, and Professor Walton even told us that not everyone can incorporate humor into their speeches because sometimes whenever you use humor, the audience isn't really receptive to it, and it can fall flat, and you need to learn how to recover to that. And apparently Dr. Terry, he's able to do this, and so that makes him unique as a role model as well. My third point is that Dr. Terry possesses patience, which is a characteristic that is held in high esteem in discussions pertaining to personal relationships and under several other circumstances. Whenever Dr. Terry is teaching a class and perhaps a student or two won't understand the material, he doesn't become discouraged or frustrated. He only tries to find new methods to help them learn, and he tries to take them step by step so they're less apt to get lost or overwhelmed. And also, whenever he comes into contact with other people's beliefs and ideas, he doesn't become condescending or puts them down because just on the sole fact that they're different than his. And so he's patient with people in this way. And just to reiterate my three points, my first main point is that Dr. Terry is a person who demonstrates on a daily basis how to be respectful and respectable. My second main point is that Professor Terry also incorporates humor into his teaching methods as a way to relate to his students in a less serious manner. And my third point is that Dr. Terry possesses patience, which is a characteristic that is held in high esteem in discussions pertaining to interpersonal relationships and under several other circumstances. Everyone needs a role model and guidance in their life to teach them how to be better people, and I believe that Dr. Terry is one of these role models. I believe that we should all learn to be respectful, respectable, humorous, and patient to set good examples ourselves for whoever else may be looking up to us. Thank you.
So we can see in her delivery that she has notes along just the back of her memorization, and there's sometimes when she refers to the notes, we can see at one point where her memory fails, so she goes back to her notes and she ends the speech. But you can see that she has memorized, and she's reciting something that she has memorized.
Excuse me, miss.
Yes?
She looked a bit nervous how she was holding her hands.
She was very nervous. You can hear it in her voice, how nervous she was. And also that might impact how well she remembered the speech. So you can actually hear an example of what you might not want to do if you've rehearsed, if you've memorized the speech, because she is a bit nervous. She's relying on her memory, but she also has notes to back her up. And at near the end, her confidence fails, and she forgets or she blanks on what she's supposed to say and goes back to her notes. So it takes a lot of practice if you are going to memorize a speech. If your memory is as bad as mine, writing a script might be a heck of a lot easier than trying to memorize it. So what I want to do now, I want to break from Canvas and you see you're here. I want to break from Canvas. So what we're going to do, a breakout room exercise. And you're going to attempt an impromptu speech. So I'm going to put up about 16 or so, 15 topics. I want you each to pick a topic. Take a minute to prepare yourself based on that topic. Yes?
Hello?
Yes?
I have no voice.
Okay, well, that means I'll have 34 people giving speeches. So what we will do, we'll split into groups of four. So you will take a minute to prepare the speech and 2 minutes to deliver the speech. So that's a total of 3 minutes per person. While your group member is giving the speech, jot down your notes on their eye contact, vocal delivery? Is the message clear? How do you react to the speech? And when we come out of the break room, you will share that analysis. So you're not sharing the analysis in the break room. The break room will allow you to give this, each of you to give the speech, so it saves us a little time, because if we were to give the speech one at a time, we will never leave. So this allows us to save a little time. So in groups of, you see a 34, so in groups of about four to five, we will split up. Each person will get a chance to just deliver the speech. While they're while the person is delivering the speech, the other group members take notes and save those notes for when we come back into the main session, okay? So we are not exchanging analyses or critiques in the breakout room. We're going to do it when we come back into the full session, right? So I'm throwing up now. These are the...
Excuse me?
Yes?
Can you just say one more time in terms of the analysis what we are looking at when our classmates speak?
So you're looking at, pay attention to eye contact, delivery, vocal delivery. Is the message clear? Organize, you know, how do you react to this speech? So this is impromptu. So what you're doing, what we're doing now is that you will have, you pick a topic, and also please let me know the topic in the chat. So you will pick
Yes? Hi, Miss. Sorry, Charlene, her electricity just went by hers. She just messaged and said electricity has gone by hers, so she can't participate.
Well, yes, thank you for putting that in the chat. Eye contact, vocal delivery, clarity, organization, and your general reaction. Barring, I know we have technological issues that we wouldn't have in a classroom setting. So for those of you who can, the ones who are here, we will split you up into groups, take a minute, study, organize yourself, and you'll have at most two minutes to deliver your speech. So here are the topics. In the chat, indicate which topic you would like to choose, what you would like to focus on. I have 18 up here, so the first 15. Let's look at the first 15. And pick your topic, let it in the chat, and we will go from... three minutes for eight people. We'll do it. We'll go from 7 to 7. This year, trying to do math in my head. I can't do math too well. 3 minutes per person and four people. Right, 12 minutes. Right. So let's say we go from 7 to 7:15. All right.
Miss, each person in the group have to read, right?
Yeah, well, it's an impromptu speech, so yes. So okay. Each person in the group, if you
have our own group, Miss?
Huh?
We pick in our own group?
No, the breakout rooms are automatic.
Okay, no problem.
Okay.
Thank you.
Just pick a topic.
Okay.
Take the minute to prepare the topic. What's your main idea? What's your main thought? How you would organize it? And then we'll spend 15 minutes in the breakout room to give everybody ample time to do their 2-minute speech, right? So we go to break room in 1 minute. Right, so I'm going to stop sharing now and we will go into the break room, right? Okay, so quickly, I'd like to share the feedback from the group session. So I would go by topic, and so invite the different members who were privy to that speech to give feedback. So let's look at topic one. Delicia, who was in the group with Delicia?
Myself.
Hello.
So what did you think of Delicia's speech?
Delicia had good eye contact, good pitch. She was organized and clear. The only flaw I could have picked up from it was sometimes she rolled her eyes. I don't know if it was nervousness, but she had that rolling eye sometimes to get her thoughts, to get all the words. So that's the only thing.
And that was Anchor, right?
Yes, miss.
Antonio, what did you think of her speech? You here? Bethany?
Yes. Her delivery was clear and the clarity was good as well. She didn't make much eye contact, a little bit disorganized, but my reaction overall good.
So one found her eye contact was good enough, and you found her she needed to make more eye contact.
I said she didn't make much eye contact because she said she was rolling her eyes a lot, so it didn't. Wasn't able to make much eye contact. You know, like she was thinking while she was saying stuff, so she was, you know, contemplating what to say.
No, miss, I just want to say, like, that rolling eyes, that's something I don't know, like from since I young, I learned to roll my eyes, and at some weird times I just roll my eyes, and I will be talking to somebody, like at work I could be talking to my manager and my eyes just rolling unconscious. I don't know what this is.
So that's something to pay attention to, especially if you have to do formal presentations, to pay attention when you're speaking. You know, roll eye in Trinidadianese mean, I think you're talking stupidness. I can't believe this person talking to me, what you're wasting my time for, right? So you might actually be communicating something that you don't intend if you, involuntarily roll your eyes a lot. So that might be something to pay attention to. So you see, not only is participating in class, you're learning new skills, but you're also learning something about yourself in your everyday communication. And, you know, you might have wondered why that person gets upset after I talk to them. It might be because you roll your eyes when you didn't mean to roll your eyes. because it means something very specific in Trinidadianese when you roll your eye at somebody.
Right? Yeah, miss, I get in enough trouble in school for it, so I know.
Right. Who was in Keshel's group? So what did you think of Keshel's speech?
Let me go first. I found that she had good eye contact, and she seemed to draw from experience. She spoke about her concern about the future, and because she was able to draw from her experience now with COVID, it came across very organized to me. Yeah.
Thank you. And who else was in Cashel's group? Anyone else want to comment?
Connie was there too, if you hear me.
Yeah, but I didn't hear Keshel's presentation. I got
calling on out, and by the time she was able to get back in, it was 19 seconds left in the breakout session, right? So I'm going to assume, Marsha, you were in the group, and because of your voice, you can't really share. So let's move on to topic 5. Who was in Danielle's group?
Missy.
So I heard a Miss Me. Not my sweetheart.
It's Danielle Alfred, right?
I neglected to write down what the last name was.
Yes, Ms. Well, I was in Danielle's group, that's for sure.
Yeah, I think it's Alfred, yes. So what did you think of her speech?
I think her speech was clear, and I understood the point that she was trying to bring across. I understood what she was saying. And, well, her message was clear, and understood basically. And well, her eye contact, it was fair, it was good. She was looking at the camera and stuff, but you know, at times she'll look down or around, but I find her eye contact was fairly good.
Thank you. And who else was in the group with Danielle?
I was.
And what did you think of her speech?
I was captured by how well she was actually able to make eye contact. Her points were clear, straight to the point, clear. She added a little bit of humor in her little delivery, which made it interesting.
Okay. So she managed to interject some personality, some humor.
Yeah, even though she had a straight face though.
Okay, good. Who was in the group with Jessica? Anyone was in a group with Jessica? Jessica Maharaj?
Excuse me, Jessica was in our group, but she got bumped off before we could start making our speeches. Okay. And then Arnold came in the end.
Okay. Androsia?
Androsia.
Who was in the group with Androsia?
Yes, miss, that was the same group. So I was in her group.
Oh, so she was able to make her speech?
Yeah.
And what did you think of her speech?
So she spoke very articulately. She was clear. She had very good eye contact. She used dialect in some areas to come off as more relatable when she was speaking about human behavior versus forgiveness being divine. Her points were also very well organized.
Thank you. Let's do a few more. Who was in the group with Maria?
I was with.
And what did you think of her speech?
Her speech was lovely. Her eyes were straight on the camera the whole time. She clearly spoke from within. She used some dialect, which let me know that she was comfortable speaking. She just seemed calm. She was proper, calm. She didn't stutter. She didn't pause. She just spoke, and she got straight to her point. Her point was clear and everything.
Okay. Thank you. Who was in the group with Carleen? Oh, well, Carleen got bumped off, so she didn't get to make her speech.
Miss, actually, I did.
You did? You got to make your speech?
Yes, miss, she was able to.
So,
let's see, Carleen. All right, so Carleen spoke about when she grew up, and just like Kishel did, because she was able to draw from actual experiences that she always told her mother, it was easy for her. So she was organized in what she said. She was clear in what she said. At times, the eye contact, she just looked away as if to like just gather what else she wanted to say. But other than that, it was pretty spot on.
Thank you. Good. So we're getting a sense then that it might sound scary. Someone pulls you in to do a speech to give you a topic and you have to go off the top of your head. But you realize how you are pulling from your own experiences. You're pulling from what you've been reading around you, what you know of the world, and you're able to come up with a straightforward, understandable, relatable message. And when you add those techniques of keeping eye contact with your audience, modulating your voice, playing with your vocal delivery, then the speech goes from being something scary and, oh my gosh, I don't know, I'm not prepared, to something you can pull off. So the basic trick is being as confident as possible while you're doing this. Know that if you're in the world and you're keeping abreast of news and what's going on, the chances of being caught off guard, that off guard feeling dissipates in about a second or two, because then you could actually start switching to experience, what you've read, what you've seen, what you know, to start answering the questions that the topic poses. Right? One more. Who was in the group with Stefan?
I'm not gonna say I, but I'm not confused. Go ahead. Okay. Miss, I was.
And what did you think?
Miss, Stefan, the only problem I had with him, he didn't maintain eye contact. His delivery was on point. You heard his passion, and he had clarity.
But he didn't contact enough.
No, because he was looking at the screen and not the camera.
Okay.
Yeah. So, when everybody finished in our group, I told him that. I say, remember me say to maintain eye contact. It wasn't him. Oops. Yeah. So that was the only problem.
So he had a technical glitch. He had a technical glitch because he looked at the screen and not at the camera.
Yeah.
So it takes a little practice because naturally we want to look at the screen because we, when we communicate in person, we look at faces. You're not going to see the face when you look at the camera. You just have to You just have to make the camera the face you're looking at. So the camera is the eye you're making contact with when you give this speech. So you feel a little disconnected, like you're floating because you're looking at the camera, not at the screen, but you're making that connection. And so it takes a little bit of practice.
Yeah.
Even worse, if you do video conferencing on your phone, you still look at your screen because you don't have to look at the camera. The screen is the camera. Right. So when we're on the computer and we're doing Zoom, or if you're using your camera and recording a video to upload later, if you're not looking at that little light at the top of your screen, if you have a laptop or at the attached web camera, you're actually not making eye contact. So it seems like I'm looking down because I'm looking at the screen. And I can't make eye contact with you. And the importance of eye contact is that we associate making eye contact with sincerity, honesty, and trustworthiness. If you can't, so you know, you say, look me in the eye and tell me that. So if you can't look someone in the eye, chances are you're lying, or you're saying something so harmful you that you really don't want to make eye contact and see that person's reaction. So if we're giving a speech and we make that eye contact, we become instantly more believable, more trustworthy. Your audience becomes more relaxed because, well, this person knows what he or she is talking about. She's being honest and direct with me. I feel confident in trusting what this person has to say. So when we are practicing in front of the mirror or whatnot, if you need to put a dot, and that dot will symbolize the light of the camera for when you have to do presentation for class, right? Put that dot there and speak to the dot. Look, make eye contact with that dot, because for now, that is the way you're going to connect with your audience via Zoom. So let me stress, go over what's on Canvas. You can go over at your own pace, take your time, absorb, reiterate what we've done today. Next week's Zoom activity will be an extemporaneous speech based on the same topics that you chose today. So the topic you chose for the impromptu speech, you're going to go home, you're going to study the topic, you're going to do all your planning, all your organization, jot down your little notes, practice as much as you can. And then for our Zoom session, we will do an extemporaneous version of the speech you just did, right? So it's also up on Canvas, so that you could reconfirm the topic you chose before. And that will be our major Zoom activity next week. So we are moving next week from classification to process analysis. So again, we're speeding up a little bit and we're going to spend a week each with the different writings. So next week we're looking at process analysis. We just looked at classification, and keep reminding yourself of the difference between classification and analysis by division, right? So when we looked at the structure of an essay, and the introduction and the conclusion were like mirror images. You know, when you do symmetry in math and you draw the line, they mirror each other. They're kind of the mirror opposites of each other, right? Mirror images. Think of ABD and classification like that. For the analysis by division, we're taking that larger category or that larger item and we're breaking it down into individual pieces to explain the whole, right? So in the first example, when we used university, we broke university down into its three main functioning components so that we can explain what a university is. In classification, we're taking that that topic, university, and we're putting it in a larger category, educational institution. So you can see how one, it might be easy to confuse the two because they have a similar mirror image approach. Also, if you go online and you look up analysis by division, you will most likely run across division essays. They tend to group them together. Again, because you're dealing with categories and subcategories. So we're either breaking down one big category into subcategories, or we're taking one subcategory and putting it in a bigger category. So they're related in that, right? So before we go, open for any questions.
I have a question, Miss. Yes. Dr. Francis, sorry. Two questions, actually. So the first question is regarding, I saw on Canvas, we have two assignments due for the 1st of November.
I just switched it. I know I think the ABD paragraph is due the 1st of November. The
right.
Classification pre-writing, which is attached to this week, is due on the 14th now.
Okay.
The expository speech, which I just added, it will be done in class next week. Right.
Okay, all right.
I should stress, if need arise, or how, depending on how the class is going, I might shift due date to accommodate. Right?
Okay.
So don't get too worried. I won't.
That's what. I'll
try not
sorry,
to
go ahead.
Too much work on you all at once, because that defeats the purpose. Right? So,
yeah.
Thank you for the question. And the second question you had?
Second question is regarding with last assignment. I saw that on this last item, you said to do a peer review, but I don't know how to do a peer review. I checked on Canvas to see if I have to put in something there to do the peer review. I don't know. Is it meant to be assigned someone? I don't know. How does that work?
Yeah, so Canvas is supposed to assign you two people to peer review. You get an email alerting you of the assignment. Now, one of the pauses or delays might be if everyone hasn't submitted on time. You might not on time to do the peer review. The peer review...
Yeah, because that's one of the requirements.
It's a requirement, but if... because we live... because we're so dependent on technology right now, if something happens and the deadline passes and you will not assign peer reviews, it will not diminish your grades to detrimental
extent. Okay.
Right? But do the peer review, because more so because it's a learning exercise. And I can't
right.
When you edit other people's things, you suddenly become aware of what grammatical errors look like. And you start to spot it in your own writing. You become more self-aware as a writer. So it helps you in marking the paper, and it helps your colleague in marking the paper, because they might not have spotted the mistake until you point it out. So you're doing two things. You're helping yourself and you're helping your peers, right? So Travis is supposed to assign it. And I can't really control if you get an assignment or not, because it's automated. It's kind of out of my hands, right? I can double check and make sure if it has a sign, if it's generated the assignment. That's as much as I can do, right? And let you all know, right?
Okay. Thank you
for your question. Any other questions?
Miss, I would like to clarify something. So the topic, when I grew up, am I supposed to put like something at the end there?
Yeah, it has like ellipses, right? My favorite joke is I tell people when I grow up, I'm going to be a rock musician.
No, because I want to make sure that we did it correct and it wasn't done wrong. So you could put something at the end there, right?
Yeah.
Okay, no.
If it's easier, don't think of when I grow up as when I reach a certain age. One of the tricks of growing older is that every time you look back, you go, I can't believe I was that young. And then 3 years later, you look back and go, I can't believe I was that young. So we actually never finish growing up. Right?
Okay.
So even though you've reached adulthood, when I grow up doesn't necessarily mean when I reach adulthood. We're always maturing. We're always reaching for something, some kind of self-improvement. So at this stage, think of it that way. And not necessarily when I grow up, I want to be a firefighter.
Okay, thank you, miss.
I have a question, Dr. Francis.
Yes?
Well, a question and a takeaway.
Go ahead.
My question, is there a time limit for the speech next week in terms of minimum and maximum amount of time?
I would say... put me on the spot. I didn't really come up with a time limit. I would say about 3 minutes.
Okay.
Which technically is possible because it's shorter. Shorter time span you have for speech, the harder it is, actually. People think the more time you have, the harder it is. No. Speaking from experience, when that clock starts to count down and you're running out of time, it's the most heartbreaking feeling you can have. Right? You can always end a speech early, but if you run out of time, you run out of time. So we're looking at, let's say, 3 minutes about. Okay. So a short, nothing too long, nothing too elaborate. You're not trying to get elected. So brief and to the point. So we'll aim for about 3 minutes, between 2 and 3 minutes.
Okay, thanks. And my takeaway?
Mm-hmm.
I take it away, Trinidadianese.
Yes. Trinidadini, we have a very special, if I'm remembering correctly, we are a high contact communicator. We have a high, what they call a high contact communication style, meaning we can say the barest minimum and convey so much because it's culturally understood.
Yes.
Right? So even with the eye, even with our language, you know, you roll your eyes, your body language, you can roll your eyes. And as soon as you roll your eyes, we know it means something very specific, right? Mm-hmm. You might hear older people in the community say, me cool your mouth. You know what that is?
No. I don't know. Okay, yeah.
Put your lips, you may cool your mouth. That's communication. Mm-hmm. Right? I used to tell people in my linguistics class, we have a habit of making up a noise or a nonsense word, but everybody know what it means.
Yes.
Oh, she fall on bradapsu. But you know what bradaps mean.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Or like I said, also the other example, all the Trinidadians I know is like, put the thing on the thing and give me the thing over there. But we know what we mean. So it's a very high context or high contact communication style. It's high context. We the context is very cultural. We know what it means. We don't have to say a lot to communicate what we need, as opposed to low context where you have to explain more. On the communication style, you get more information at a time, right? So we tend to confuse it. If you get two Trinidadians in a group and we speak, we can confuse people because we will say things and you're like, they're speaking English, but I have no idea what they mean. Because we understand the context. We grew up in the context. We know that, right? Yeah, so I tell someone, why is she so? But you know what I mean when I say, why is she so? We know what so means. Right? So, yeah, Trinidadianese is my short term. My official designation for it is Trinidad and Tobago Vernacular English. TTVE. But Trinidadianese sounds better. So, any other questions or comments?
That's it, Francis.
Yes?
Really and truly, I wonder what's the final, since you were playing the videos, and I didn't ask the question back then, but the video with the guy speaking about the Afghanistan thing, right? Mm-hmm. I really can't remember the name of what type of speech he was giving there. I forgot.
Extemporaneous.
Right, that word.
Yes.
No, I remembered you said that type of speech is more or less a little bit of memorizing or going over the speech. Correct me if I'm wrong, but what I realized to the end of the video, to me, he more or less sounded like if that was practiced. That's what I gathered from the ending. It sounded a bit practiced to me, especially with the aspect of the questions and the answers. You know, I know you said that probably he went over it so much times that when the guy asked the questions, he had the answer ASAP. But to me, it sounded like if they more or less practiced that whole session there as well. So I don't know if you could just...
The questioner seems a little shady because he sounds like he memorized the questions.
Yeah, he sounds like, okay, they memorized. They sound like if that session there where the question was sent out and he had the answer ASAP, it sounds like if they practiced that part on a whole, naturally.
Well, in a bit, yes. So if you're doing an extemporaneous speech, and say you're doing a presentation and you expect question and answers, you will also practice fielding questions and answers. Now, the telltale sign that he's rehearsed it a bunch of times as opposed to memorize something and just reciting it is the level of comfort and confidence in his voice, right? So if it's something we are reciting, mm-hmm. And body language experts would tell you that, and I never remember which side it is because I'm semi-dyslexic and I mix up directions very easily, right? So I never remember if it's looking up to the left or looking up to the right, but you look up, your eye contact, you actually look up, and it has to do with the hemispheres of the brain, right? So if the right side is more analytical, the left side is more imaginative. And so experts say when you're telling lies, you look up to the left because you're creating something. And when you're reciting and you're trying to jog your memory, you look up to the right because you're using that portion, that memory, that analytical memory, right? So here, if we learned it to recite it, he's reached the point where he does not have to access his memories when asked a specific question.
Okay, I understand. But because, as I said, it seems so like...
But
I think it out, you know, like if it was a play and they practice the question. So the guy asked the question so quickly and then he answered, you know, one time. So I was like, okay.
I think it's extemporaneous.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the questions were recited.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact that he didn't have to access, he did not see him at all make that upward glance, access memory, and come back. So it suggests that a familiarity with the topic to the point where you can ask me anything and I will rattle off the answer.
Okay.
You know?
Did they get that same concept where, you know, like for extempore competitions in Trinidad? Did they take that same concept from just the word extemporaneous?
Well, it's interesting because the way it's used in speech delivery, extemporaneous is actually closer to impromptu.
Right.
In just regular parlance.
Mm-hmm.
If we're talking about speech delivery, this is prepared, but from notes. So the extemporaneity is coming up with the words and the sentences, constructing them more or less on the spot. Easier to do the more you practice. With extempore calypso, on the other hand, it is completely impromptu.
Okay.
Pull a topic from a hat.
Yeah, yeah.
Create a song on the spot. So the entire thing is generated on the spot, impromptu.
Okay.
But if you look up the meaning of extemporaneous, in its broadest sense, that's what it means. I'm making it up on the spot and just going.
Right.
So the difference between the impromptu speech and the extemporaneous speech is that the impromptu speech is completely off your guard. Never saw the topic before in your life. And you make up as you go. Extemporaneous speech, you know your topic, you know your basic information. But you're not reading a script, so you're actually generating the sentences in the moment.
Right.
So again, general advice, as you're preparing the extemporaneous speech, practice saying it different ways so that you don't catch yourself off guard going, no, that's not the sentence I meant, and then you get lost. Right? But I would also advise if you scripted speech or if you're reciting, do not be afraid if you go off script, quote unquote, either reading or reciting. Make sure that you practice enough that you know what the topic is, you know what your message is. So even if you rephrase the sentence, you can catch yourself and continue. Right? Now, I don't know if y'all remember that video, that example of the very bad politician who wanted to be the treasurer. Y'all remember that?
Yeah.
The discussion? And he was reading. So he was doing a scripted speech, but he was trying to make eye contact in a very scary way. And he tried to use movement and body language also again in a very scary way, and he was not modulating his voice, so he sounded like he wanted to go attack somebody. But on top of all of that, when he stepped away, did his gestures and came back, he lost his place and would actually reread something he just said. So there was a whole lot of bad going on in that example, right? So the more you practice, the more comfortable you would be with going off script or changing the script on the fly and coming back, right? So any other questions? I see we have about 5 minutes. If you have no more questions, we can wrap up. You're free to go if you have
any questions.
Have another question.
Good night, everyone.
You have a good night.
Bye. Good night, everyone.
Bye, everyone.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, everyone.
Good night, everyone. Yeah, bye.
Good night, Miss. Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Good night.
Excuse me, sir. So I have not gotten a group member or partner for the topic on if I was an alien to express the nonverbal communication to the alien. I reached out to Maria, but she already submitted, they said they submitted today. So I was wondering, and I put it up in the group, but I didn't see anybody respond the message back as yet. So I was wondering if it is I would have been able to do it on my own, seeing that I'm not getting any feedback at this time with regards to.
Yes, you can do it on your own. One of the issues we had this semester is that people joined way after the semester actually started, and so we're playing catch up. So
I'm guilty of that, and that is due to, and I'm still waiting is to get, like, I'm going to take out a loan, so I'm waiting to get clearance from the loan, because I cannot take any more. I would not get approved. I have a degree already, and